Recorded Books presents Dead for a Dollar, a Firestick Western by William W. Johnstone, narrated by Brian Hutchison. Chapter 1. They had the Grizz cornered. Late the previous day, after interrupting the massive bear's feed on a young beef he'd dragged away from one of the ranches out on the flat, they'd driven him into a wide-mouthed box canyon in the Vieja foothills. Before they were able to get a clear shot at him, though, he disappeared into the underbrush and trees back deep in the canyon. Since going into a thicket after a riled grizz ranked almighty close to a death wish, they decided instead to back off and settle for waiting him out. With high steep cliffs rising out of the thicket on three sides, the bear had only one way to go when he got thirsty enough or hungry enough or mad enough at the thought of that half-eaten beef he'd been chased away from. And when he made his move, they'd be ready. Hopefully.
"I'd be a sight more comfortable if this canyon mouth was narrower," stated Jim Moosejaw Hendricks, squinting against the early morning sunlight angling down out of the east.
He was a big man, massive through the shoulders, thick torsoed, 6.5 feet in height. His broad, fleshy face showed its share of wear and weathering, yet still belied his nearly 50 years of age. Standing next to him, Malachi Beartooth Skinner arched a brow and replied, "Hell, if you're going to wish for comfort, why not go all the way and wish we was home in our beds instead of camped out here in the path of an ornery grizzly we've gone out of our way to piss off?"
Skinner was right at the 50 mark, age-wise, maybe a year or two one way or the other. He'd lost exact count somewhere along the way. He stood an even 6 feet tall, was built lean and leathery, with a narrow, slightly wedge-shaped face tapering down to a deeply dimpled chin that seemed well-suited to the wide, roguish grin he tended to frequently display. A few feet away from this pair, straightening up from having just poured himself a cup of coffee out of the big pot simmering on the coals at the edge of their campfire, Elwood Firestick McQueen glanced over at his two companions and said,
"Sounds to me like you two are getting soft, wasting time wishing this and hoping for that. You'd think we've been roughing it out here for a month of Sundays instead of for only one night."
McQueen, the oldest of the trio at the mid-50s mark, stood a shade over 6 feet. He was broad-shouldered and solidly built with a square, stern face dominated by penetrating ice-blue eyes. Responding defensively to Firestick's remark, Moosejaw said,
"Well, it was a blamed cold night, and a long one."
"What's more,"
added Beartooth, aiming his cocked brow in the direction of Firestick,
"I heard you doing your share of muttering and cussing over there during the night, too. Trying to settle yourself and keep warm."
"Okay. Maybe we're all getting soft," allowed Firestick.
"The point is, there was a time, not so very long ago, when sleeping on the ground in conditions a whole lot worse than last night was a way of life for the three of us. We went months, and sometimes years, without a roof over our heads, or a proper bed underneath us. All I'm saying is that a little taste of it now and again ain't gonna kill us, and therefore ain't worth so much fretting and fussing."
"Maybe so," Beartooth said.
"But that little taste might have gone down easier if, like I said a minute ago, we wasn't planted smack in the path of that grizz."
"That's right," agreed Moosejaw. "It was more than just the cold night air had me worried about the ruination of my health."
It had been close to evening yesterday when the three men drove the bear into the canyon. They reasoned he would likely stay put for the night. To help make sure, they'd built three large campfires at intervals spaced across the width of the canyon's mouth. Each man had taken a post at one of the fires, with his rifle kept at the ready and his horse picketed close by to provide early warning in case the grizz decided to go on the prowl, in spite of the fires and the man sent accompanying them. This bear had proven more than once to have no fear, and maybe even a little hatred, when it came to humans trying to interfere in his business. Starting just short of a month prior, the grizzly had begun making it his business to feed on cattle
and sometimes horses, to be found on ranches scattered over the grasslands below the Vieja Mountains. Since the Viejas didn't normally see much in the way of bear activity, it was speculated that this one, a rogue of some sort, must have wandered down from farther north right after the spring thaw. Whatever his origins, he showed up big and mean and hungry, and the ranchers soon took alarmed note of his attacks on their stock. Attempts to get in the grizz's way had resulted in one death, two serious maulings, and three or four additional close calls. It hadn't taken long before all of this was brought to the attention of the men now camped at the mouth of the nameless Box Canyon, where the bear was cornered. Folks in the area had several reasons to look to these three for help and for them to agree to try and provide it. For starters, they represented the law in Buffalo Peak, the nearby town that supplied goods and services to the various ranches now being threatened by the bear. Firestick was the town marshal, Beartooth and Moosejaw, his deputies. While bear attacks on outlying ranches didn't normally fall in the category of what most town lawmen might concern themselves with, and technically would fall outside their jurisdiction even if they did, the way Firestick and his deputies approached upholding the law tended to allow room for a fair amount of leeway when it came to formalities like jurisdiction. What was more, in this particular case, the backgrounds of the three made them qualified beyond their badges for dealing with the problem at hand. Prior to arriving and settling in West Texas, each had spent nearly three decades roaming the mountainous regions to the north and farther west. Among the last of a dying breed, they'd been mountain men, living wild and free, and making their way by hunting and trapping in the high reaches, far from the encroachment of so-called civilization. During this time, they'd had their share of bear encounters, individually in their younger years, and then later after they'd bonded as friends and partners. It was also during those years together that they had earned, from Indians with whom they frequently skirmished, the colorful nicknames they continued to carry with them even after they quit the mountains and came to the Texas prairie. Firestick, due to McQueen's uncanny accuracy with a rifle. Beartooth, for Skinner's prowess with a knife that he kept as sharp and wielded as deadly as a grizzly's fang. And Moosejaw, resulting from the occasion where an otherwise weaponless Hendricks was caught by surprise, yet successfully fended off a band of Hikarilla braves using only the jawbone from a moose skeleton he found on the floor of the canyon where they had attempted to trap him. These credentials, colorful names notwithstanding, were what prompted the ranchers in the area to look to the three for taking the lead in dealing with the bear. In addition to responding as friends and neighbors, and out of whatever obligation they felt as local lawmen, the three also had a personal stake in the matter. Upon first settling in the valley, before donning badges for the town, the three had started their own small horse ranch, the Double M, for mountain men, not too far to the south, meaning they had stock of their own at risk to the marauder.
"Well, the cold night air and sleeping on the uncomfortable ground is past us for now," said Firestick, after pausing to blow a cooling breath across his coffee. "But we all know what ain't past us, and what we can't allow to get by whenever he decides he's ready to make his try. If we let him succeed, we'll be facing more nights of the same."
Moosejaw made a sour face.
"If he succeeds in getting past us, that could mean we won't be left in any shape to face more of anything."
"Throw that sort of talk out of here," responded Beartooth, scowling. "If Mr. Grizz shows his face in the daylight, where one of us can draw a clear bead on him, the only one ending up in bad shape will be him."
"I like the sound of that," Firestick agreed. "But it all hinges on the little matter of when the Grizz decides to make his run. I figure it least likely for the middle of the day."
Beartooth nodded.
"That leaves earlier dusk, and we're already slipping past what you could call early."
"I can't see him waiting all the day till dusk," said Moosejaw. "There ain't no water back there in that thicket, and I don't reckon his belly is all the way satisfied. Not after we chased him off in the middle of feeding on that beef kill yesterday."
I'm inclined to think the same. Over the brim of his upraised coffee cup, Firestick squinted in the direction of the deep thicket.
I expect our fires from last night and our palaverin' out here now in plain sight are holding the rascal back some. But at the same time, his thirst or hunger, or plain orneriness, are likely working to prod him out of there.
In that case, said Beartooth, we're best off spreading back out and taking up our night positions again. Even when our friend leaves the thicket, he'll have some cover in those patches of high grass poking up out there across the middle of the canyon. Being on the lookout from different angles will give us our best chance to spot him as soon as possible.
The sooner the better, Moosejaw seconded. The quicker we can turn that critter into a bearskin rug, the better it'll be for everybody.
No argument on any of that out of me, said Firestick. You fellas go ahead on back to your posts. I'll keep the coffee pot full and hot. In case we're wrong, and Mr. Grizz takes a notion to drag things out for a spell, you can always mosey back for a fresh cup of mud to keep from getting too bored.
Beartooth made a face.
I've never been a fan of being bored, and I sure as hell am all for getting this business over and done with. But you'll have to excuse me for saying that, on second thought, in this case finding myself a mite bored if that dang bear turns out not to be in a hurry to come rushing out at us. Well, for a while anyway, that wouldn't be an altogether bad thing.
His two pals chuckled a bit at his admission before allowing as to how they understood exactly what he meant. Then, each of them taking a fresh poured cup of coffee with them, Beartooth and Moosejaw went on back to the positions they'd maintained throughout the night, one toward either side of the canyon's mouth. At daybreak, with no bear activity having taken place to that point, they'd let their respective fires dwindle down and had converged on Firestick's center position where they cooked coffee and palavered about how they were going to proceed. Now, with that decided, they were extending the waiting game, leaving it for the Grizz to decide when he was ready to try his luck. Survival in the mountains had required many traits: skill, endurance, luck. But patience was always a key ingredient. Patience when setting out a trap line, patience when on the hunt, patience when stalking or being stalked by an enemy, man or beast. So the three former mountain men knew well how to play the waiting game. They might be a little rusty or soft, as Firestick had implied, but not so much that they didn't have another round left in them, and one they damn sure reckoned to make end in their favor.
All up to the Grizz to make the next move, Firestick told himself, as he refilled the coffee pot from a partially depleted water bag, set to the makings, then placed the pot back on the coals to start brewing. He'd also fed a few sticks into the fire to keep it burning strong enough for the coffee to boil and stay hot. That done, he hoisted the water bag again and carried it over to where his horse was picketed. Removing his hat, he filled it with water and held it for the animal to drink, like his companions had done for their horses earlier. He noted that plenty of graze still remained within easy reach of the big gelding. When the horse had slaked its thirst, Firestick shook out his hat and returned to the campfire. He put the water bag down, reached for the half-emptied cup of coffee he'd left sitting on the grass, then squatted on his heels beside his war bag. Tipping up the cup and swallowing some of its now tepid contents, his gaze again went to the heavy underbrush deep in the recess of the canyon. The sun was climbing higher in the sky, and the morning air was starting to warm, chasing away the last of the night's chill. It was early enough in the spring that the days were getting bright and warm, though the nights remained quite brisk. The air was still, no hint of a breeze. Firestick found himself wishing for one that would carry the scent of the Grizz when he began to move around, so that the picketed horses might pick it up and give warning. If the breeze was right, the horses would sense the bear's movement before any of the men had the chance to spot him. As he continued to stare into the canyon, Firestick's right hand drifted down and brushed against one of the two rifles resting across his war bag. One of these was a Winchester repeater, the popular Yellow Boy model that Firestick favored. The second weapon
the one his hand brushed against, was a single-shot Hawken muzzleloader. Old Thunder. He'd carried this rifle for most of his years up in the mountains, this very one, in fact, whose fine balance and accuracy and powerful 50-caliber punch had earned him the nickname he carried to this day. From the standpoint of plain practicality, eventually, Firestick had shifted more to the use of a repeater. Since taking on the job of town marshal, he'd also adapted to carrying a sidearm, namely the walnut-handled Frontier Colt 44, currently riding in the holster on his right hip. Yet while his natural skill and keen eye served well in the use of any kind of firearm, up to and including the discovery he possessed uncommon speed when it came to drawing and firing the Colt, his Hawken continued to hold a special meaning for Firestick. These days, except for taking it down periodically to clean and fire a few target rounds, the finely crafted gun rested on hooks over the parlor doorway at the Double M Ranch House. Upon preparing to head out for this bear hunt, however, Firestick had decided that the unmatched accuracy and added punch of his old friend might very well come in handy. The right placement of a 50-caliber ball hurled from its precisely bored muzzle would bring a quick, clean end to the grizzly's reign of terror. With this thought running through his head once again, Firestick's gaze narrowed into a glare, and he muttered under his breath, "So show your shaggy old head, you stubborn cuss, and see what I got waiting for you." But the utterance met only silence. No sound, no movement from deep in the canyon. The only noise came from the nearby coffee pot as its contents started to bubble and boil. Catching scent of the aroma that accompanied this, Firestick tossed away what was left in his cup, figuring to replace it with hot, fresh brew in another few minutes. A glance toward the east caused him to wonder if, what with the sun continuing its steady climb and no sign of movement by the grizz, he and his pals might not be in for a long day of nursing coffee. Scarcely had this thought crossed his mind before something, an intangible sense, a prickling in the short hairs on the back of his neck, demanded his attention. His head snapped back around, and he once more glared into the canyon, scouring the thick growth curving along its deepest recesses. Still, no movement, no sound from there. Yet something had triggered the instinctive warning in him, the kind of unsettled feeling he sometimes got when danger was close at hand. It wasn't something Firestick could define or describe, but times when he'd felt it in the past, it had proven right, and thereby saved his hide, too often to be ignored. But what was it trying to tell him on this occasion? Something about the bear, most likely. But what? Where? Firestick glanced over at Beartooth, about 50 yards to his right, and then toward Moosejaw, an equal distance to his left. Neither of them seemed to have an awareness of anything amiss. Same for any of their horses. What the hell? Was he losing his touch? Was his trusted, warning instinct steering him wrong, letting him down? And then from deep in the bowels of the canyon, amplified and echoing off the surrounding cliff walls, came the thunderously fierce roar of the grizz. Chapter 2.
"That's our boy! He's on the move!" shouted Beartooth.
"I damn well heard him, but I can't see anything yet," responded Moosejaw. "Don't worry. You will soon enough," Firestick cautioned both of them.
He was standing straight up now, feet planted wide, and facing square into the canyon with the Hawken secure in his grip. A quick glance to either side showed Beartooth and Moosejaw poised similarly with their own rifles raised and ready. Back a ways, the horses were beginning to snort and skitter somewhat nervously. Firestick swung his eyes back to the canyon, sweeping them in tight scrutiny for a sign of something to accompany the hackle's raising roar. The beast sounded again, another powerful bellow, followed by some short, choppy snarls, and then the curious, almost goat-like bleating sound a bear will sometimes make when it's highly agitated. The roars had been a warning. Here I come. The snarls and bleats meant he was actually on the move, following through on the warning.
There, on the left, Moosejaw suddenly shouted. He's coming through the high grass on my side.
Firestick saw it then, saw the tips of the tall grasses shivering and swaying as the bear made his way through them. The crafty devil was already well clear of the thicket, evidently having advanced stealthily out of the underbrush and along one side of the canyon's middle area.
Make it hot for him, Firestick called. Even if you can't get a clear shot, see if you can drive him toward the center, where the grass is shorter and me and Beartooth can throw in a little something to help make him feel welcome. If you get a shot with that Hawkin', make it count, Moosejaw hollered back.
That's the general idea, Firestick told him through clenched teeth. A moment later, Moosejaw began levering rapid-fire rounds with his Winchester, riddling the outside edge of the swaying high grass. The bear roared in protest, but kept on the move. At first, it didn't look like he was going to change course, but then, just as Firestick was getting ready to shift to his left in order to try and help Moosejaw intercept the charging beast, the bear veered toward the middle of the canyon. For a fleeting second, he was visible as he passed from the stand of tall grass and crossed a narrow, rocky-bottomed span where the grass grew much shorter. He was a huge brute, Firestick saw, with a head as big as a wagon wheel, probably weighing between 800 and 900 pounds. Unfortunately, the glimpse that showed Firestick this, because he'd been caught starting his turn to move toward Moosejaw, was too brief for him to get off a shot. By the time he'd wheeled back and again raised the Hawken, the bear had plunged into another patch of higher grass that made him invisible, except for the shivering, swaying growth. Now, Beartooth opened up with his rifle, sending a rain of sizzling lead that sawed the grass and chewed the ground ahead of the grizz's new direction. The quarry bellowed and bawled with increasing rage. The canyon mouth, so quiet only minutes earlier, was suddenly filled with a cacophony of noises, the crack of rifle fire, the increasingly louder protests of the bear, accompanied by the crash and rustle of him stomping closer, all backgrounded by the snorts and shrill whinnies of the horses in their growing alarm. Beartooth added to this, shouting between trigger pulls, "He's turning again! We got him zigzagging, but there ain't no backup in him! He's gonna be busting out into the clear any second now, and it looks like he's gonna be headed straight for you, Firestick!" With old Thunder raised to his shoulder and the second trigger already set, Firestick sighted down the barrel and raked out, "Let him come. He'll find out there ain't no backup in me neither." The ground across the canyon mouth, sandier and more exposed to the elements, was covered with shorter, coarser grass than that farther into the canyon. When the bear emerged into this, charging suddenly out of the taller inner grass, he was once again fully in view. And this time, it wasn't merely for a fleeting glimpse. He was right there, only 50 yards in front of Firestick's position, barreling full steam on all fours with furious intent to escape the canyon, and woe be to anything in his way. His fangs were bared and shiny with saliva. An ominous rumbling was issuing from his massive chest, and his blazing yellow eyes seemed locked fiercely on Firestick as he bounded directly toward him. Even as he steadied his sights on a spot between those blazing eyes and just above that savagely gaping mouth, Firestick was aware of both Moosejaw and Beartooth converging on his position, meaning to try and help intercept the advancing beast. Because they were firing wildly as they ran, not taking time to aim carefully, Firestick saw a few of their bullets striking the shaggy body and giving off puffs of dust, but as many or more were sailing wide or gouging into the ground. None of the rounds that hit the grizz seemed to slow him at all. Which was why Firestick continued to take steady, careful aim, meaning to make sure he triggered a kill shot by penetrating the thick skull and planting a 50-caliber ball in the brain beneath. But the same instant he stroked the Hawkins firing trigger, the grizz stepped in a sharp rut with his right forepaw and lurched abruptly to one side. This staggered him momentarily, but did little to slow him down. What it did do, unfortunately, was cause him to jerk his head far enough to the side so that Firestick's shot missed where it had been intended, and instead clipped a large chunk off the bear's left ear and smashed into its shoulder. The impact was enough to stagger the beast harder, almost stopping him this time. But again, only momentarily. Then he was surging forward once more, emitting a roar of pain and rage as he came. Realizing he didn't have time to reload the Hawken, Firestick set aside the muzzle loader and quickly snatched up his yellow boy. Beartooth and Moosejaw had both skidded to a halt and were now bracing to take careful aim before doing any more shooting. With the lighter caliber guns, it was going to for sure take a headshot, maybe more than one, to bring the beast down. And with him less than 20 yards from Firestick and building up speed, every trigger pull had to count. Nobody was more keenly aware of this than Firestick, as he levered around into the yellow boy's chamber and slammed the butt to his shoulder. He calculated he might only have time for as few as 2 shots before the grizz would be on him. Once again, the bear jerked his head sharply to the side just as Firestick squeezed the trigger. Only this time, it wasn't a wrong step by the animal that caused this. It was something far more violent. The grizz's head was snapped viciously to its right, and in conjunction with a movement, a thick spray of blood, skull fragments, and brain tissue was slung through the air. An instant later, the dull, rolling boom of a heavy-caliber rifle, quite different from the reports of the Winchesters going off, rolled across the mouth of the canyon. Simultaneously riddled by Winchester bullets, as well as the powerful slug striking the side of its head, the grizz toppled in mid-stride, as if its legs had suddenly turned to mush, and crashed heavily to the ground. It skidded for a few feet on the stubbly grass and came to rest no more than a dozen feet short of Firestick. Chapter 3. The mystery rifleman, who had delivered the headshot to the charging grizz, had fired from atop a high shoulder of a brushy, tree-dotted ground off to the east, several hundred yards past the spot where Beartooth had stood his night post. This much was evident to the breathless trio, now bunched in the canyon mouth as they turned their heads toward where the booming report seemed to have originated. The haze of powder smoke still hanging in the air, where their gazes settled, provided confirmation. "I don't know who's up there," Beartooth muttered, "but he sure made one hell of a shot."
"You don't have to tell me," Firestick said, "but who he is and why he's up there to begin with still remains to be seen. So until we know more about that, I think we'd best spread out some and stay on guard."
Moosejaw frowned.
"That shot likely just saved your life. Why be suspicious about whoever was behind it? If he meant any harm, don't you reckon he would have just left it up to the bear?"
Firestick continued to stare up at the fading trace of powder smoke, saying,
"Could be. Then again, could be it's somebody with a personal axe to grind, and don't want anybody or anything else to handle it. Let's hold off judgment until we can be sure."
Bowing to Firestick's reasoning and the unspoken leadership role he had assumed among the three over the years, Moosejaw and Beartooth drifted a few feet off to either side. Each man then stood with his rifle balanced across the crook of one arm and held his gaze trained on the shoulder of high ground to see who was going to emerge. In short order, a man on horseback came out of the brush near the base of the high ground. The horse picked its way sure-footedly down the last of the incline, and the man leaned back easy in his saddle, giving the animal its head. A few feet behind came a modestly loaded pack mule on a tether line, the rider gripped in one hand. When the stranger and his animals reached level ground, they continued unhurriedly toward the men who stood waiting. As he drew nearer, the features of the horseman became clearer. He was a heavily bearded individual with quite a few years on him, judging by the streaks of gray in the beard and the kind of thickened torso that often comes with middle age. He appeared to be somewhat average in height and build, clad in well-worn buckskins and a tobacco-colored slouch hat perched on an unruly thatch of hair much in need of barbering. The closer he got, though, what stood out more than anything was the wide, lopsided grin plastered on his face. Then, on the heels of a deep, throaty chuckle, he called ahead,
"What's the matter with you slack-jawed polecats? Ain't a one of you got no greeting for an old friend from the high and lonely reaches?"
Three mouths dropped open as one.
"Cuthbert, is that you?" said Moosejaw.
"Ripley, you doggone scalawag," declared Beartooth.
Firestick's mouth stretched into a wide grin of its own.
"I'll be damned. Rip Ripley, you old trapline pirate. It really is you."
The buckskinned horseman let out a whoop.
"Hallelujah. I was afraid maybe y'all's eyesight had gone bad, or that the lot of you had turned too flatland stupid to recognize an old pal."
"The sight of you could sure enough rate as stupefying, I'll admit that much," Firestick told him.
"And speaking of eyesight, that shot you just made showed plain enough there ain't nothing wrong with yours."
"You can say that again," said Beartooth. "That was a good 500 yards if it was an inch. I never knew you to have such an eagle eye, Rip."
"That's because whenever Firestick was around, he sucked all the air out of anybody else ever getting recognized for their shooting skill,"
Rip replied. Then, arching one shaggy brow and aiming it directly at Firestick, he added,
"Which makes me wonder, how did the great Firestick manage to miss that big old grizz from such a short range?"
The teasing remark brought a bit of a flush to Firestick's rugged features. But rather than let it rile him, he twisted his mouth wryly and responded,
"I didn't miss that blamed critter. I just didn't hit him where I meant to."
"Yeah," said Rip, with exaggerated seriousness. "Sometimes the sun can get in the eyes of even the best shooter."
"Wasn't no danged sun involved, and you all know it," Firestick growled,
fighting not to let the gentle ribbing get to him.
"The bear stepped in a rut and jerked to one side just as I shot, causing me to miss sinking a ball between his eyes.
Wasn't no time for another try with the hawking, so all that was left was to try and finish the job with our Winchesters.
Luckily, you didn't miss a head strike, Rip, and I'll be the first one to say it was a hell of a shot, and one that most likely saved my bacon."
"Maybe all our bacon," Moosejaw said, somberly.
Ripley scrunched up his face.
"Aw, hell. There ain't no fun in ribbing y'all if you're gonna be so doggone agreeable. If I can't get a good rise out of any of you, what good is it? Ain't like I can go back up in the mountains and work up an argument with the old bunch trying to convince them I outshot Firestick neither.
On account of there's none of the old bunch left to listen."
Beartooth's forehead creased.
"All of them are gone? All of them who ever amounted to anything. A lot of them went under permanent-like. A few others just wandered back on down to the flats like you fellas done."
Ripley sighed.
"Oh, some fresh blood, some younger pups, show up from time to time, looking for a piece of the old glory, hungry for an adventure they can tell their grandbabies about somewhere down the road. Like the trails we blazed, the life we led was nothing but some kind of game."
Rip paused, gazing off at something far away for a moment before continuing.
"I wet-nursed a couple of those pups in order to keep their sorry asses from starving and dying without they ever made it through their first winter. But it didn't take long for that to get old and empty feeling."
He sighed again.
"So I finally got around to coming on down out of the high reaches myself."
"Is that what brought you to our neck of the woods?"
Moosejaw wanted to know. Ripley found his grin again.
"In a roundabout way, yeah. Stories about you three settling here and pinning on badges for crying out loud spread all the way up to the high country there toward the end, when they was still a few who remembered you to pass word around. And I recalled how Firestick often talked about his hankering to see Texas someday. So, after knocking around some and never really finding a place to fit in, I figured what was the hay. Decided I'd stick me a toe into this here Texas and see if it maybe suited me in the way it seems to have you fellas."
"Well, I'm glad you came for a look-see. And I'm particularly glad for the timing you picked to show up," Firestick said.
Ripley thumbed back the brim of his hat and leaned forward to rest a forearm across his saddle pommel.
"Now that's real good to hear. Gotta admit, I was starting to wonder just how welcome my showing up truly was."
Beartooth frowned. "What makes you say that, Rip? What gives you any cause to think otherwise?" Ripley lifted his brows innocently.
"The thing is,
and you gotta forgive me, seeing's how I'm a stranger in these parts, and maybe not understanding the way things are rightly done hereabouts, but we've been palavering a good long while now, and I can't help noticing how there ain't nobody yet offered to break out a jug and commence with the kind of proper howdy-do a body might expect for a pack of old friends meeting up again after so long.
The three lawmen exchanged glances. Then, with a mildly sheepish grin, Firestick explained, "The long and short of it, I'm afraid, is that our purpose in being out here didn't seem to call for fetching along any kind of jug. However, I got a pot of fresh brewed over here," he gestured, "that the Grizz didn't quite make it far enough to wreck. We'd be mighty proud to share a cup of that with you."
"Oh, now there's a big step in the right direction," Ripley said. "After I saw your fires last night when it was too dark to make out who you was or figure what you was up to, I made me a cold cam. Then I rose with the sun and right off went to the skulk to satisfy my curiosity. In other words, I ain't had me no coffee in too dang long. What's more, it happens I got me a jug back on my pack mule that, lessen y'all have developed some kind of religion against it, could sweeten up a cup or two extra fine."
"Seems to me like your showing up here keeps turning out better and better," said Beartooth.
"So light down off that hay burner, fetch your jug, and let's have us some sweetened up coffee."
For the next half hour, the four men sat or squatted around Firestick's campfire and swapped stories about the old days and then some of the more recent ones, filling one another in on happenings since they'd last been together. As they talked, they drank coffee laced with generous splashes from Ripley's jug of busthead. Eventually, Ripley got around to giving more details about how he'd come to make his fateful appearance there that very morning. He'd been working his way down through the Viejas, he explained, aiming for the town of Buffalo Peak, where he'd heard his old friends were keeping the peace these days. Night caught up with him before he made it out of the mountains, and since he'd spotted Bear Sign earlier in the day, he hadn't wanted to risk traipsing around too long after dark. It was as he was searching for a sheltered niche to make camp that he'd caught sight of the fires Firestick and the others had lighted across the mouth of the canyon.
"Reckon I already told the rest of it from there," the newcomer concluded. "I found your fires mighty intriguing, but even though I was curious, I figured I also needed to be cautious. And then, after I spied who you was come morning, I still couldn't quite feature what in blazes you was up to until I spotted that big old Grizz slipping out of the thicket and making his way crafty-like through all that tall grass."
"So you must have saw the bear was on the move before we realized it," said Moosejaw.
Rip nodded.
"'Spect so. I had the advantage of looking down. By then I'd also figured out what you three was set up for, laying in wait for that critter to try and make his break. That's when I made up my mind to just sit tight, where I had elevation and a stout tree branch to steady my rifle on, and be ready to lend a hand if needed."
"Well, it turned out you sure were needed," declared Firestick. "You and that long-shooting rifle gun of yours. What are you packing there? That's a Sharp's Big 50, ain't it?"
"Indeed so," confirmed Rip. "54 caliber, actually, in this case. Fires a pre-packed, breech-loaded cartridge. Kicks like a mule with three hind legs, but shoots straight and sweet. And as you saw, knocks down anything it hits. I traded an old buffalo hunter for it a couple years back. Swapped him a squaw I'd grown tired of, and an Appaloosa stud I hated to part with."
He paused for a swallow of his coffee, and then, after gazing far off for another moment, added,
"'Spect that buffalo hunter has grown tired of the squaw himself by now. She had her uses on long, cold nights, but otherwise, she had hard ways about her that could grind on a body something fierce," he sighed. "I still kind of miss that Appaloosa, though."
Chapter 4. It was noon by the time Firestick rode back into Buffalo Peak. The way he'd left things at the canyon mouth was that Moosejaw and Ripley would remain there to field dress and skin the bear. Since Ripley's shot had put the beast down, it was decided he'd earned the right to the pelt.
It was further decided that Ripley would be staying as a guest at the Double M Ranch for a few days, and so, while Firestick returned to town to check on things there and start spreading the news about the killer grizzly being dispatched, Beartooth had ridden on to the Double M to arrange preparations on that front. Victoria Kingsley, the cook and housekeeper at the ranch, who, just incidentally, also happened to be romantically involved with Beartooth, would need to know to set an added plate for supper and undoubtedly would want to fix something special. And since there were no spare rooms in the main house, Miguel Santos and his nephew, Jesus Marquez, the two vaqueros hired to help work the horse herd at the ranch, needed to be advised they would be sharing space in the bunkhouse with Ripley. As he trotted his horse down Trail Street, the main artery of Buffalo Peak, Firestick couldn't quite keep the hint of a smile off his lips. Seeing Ripley again, rehashing some of the old adventures, and then thinking about even a few more as he'd been riding in, had that kind of effect. Cuthbert Rip Ripley had always been a character, a wild man capable of saying and doing the kind of outlandish things that, though they sometimes came close to getting him killed, made for tales that could be told and retold to the lasting enjoyment of others. Some who actually knew him, some who only heard the tales. Either way, they were the kind of stories that helped make the hard, sometimes brutal life of a mountain man more bearable. As long as there was somebody like Rip Ripley out there, enduring the same things you were, but doing it with such a rake-hell flourish, then it somehow meant conditions couldn't be as bad as they otherwise might seem. As he became aware of drawing attention from citizens lining the street on either side, Firestick put away his half-smile and adopted an expression better suited for a lawman on duty. Most of the onlookers, he suspected, knew that he and his deputies had been out hunting the grizzly and were probably eager to hear how it had gone. The fact neither Beartooth nor Moosejaw were riding in with him likely only added to their curiosity. He'd see to it, word got spread soon enough. But first things came first, and that meant a stop at the building that housed his office and the jail. After climbing out of the saddle and hitching his horse to the rail in front of the sturdy adobe-walled structure at the west end of Trail Street, Firestick strode inside, anticipating the coolness he knew would be waiting within the thick walls. At its midday peak in the sky, the sun had grown bright and hot, and the marshal was looking forward to getting out of it for a while.
"Ah, now, welcome back. Since you're standing upright and appear not to have been mauled or chewed upon, am I to conclude the hunt was successful or inconclusive?"
The greeting that met Firestick as he came through the door was voiced by an average-sized, elderly gent seated on a chair over by the side window. He had a neatly trimmed mustache and a few long, thin strands of hair combed straight back over the otherwise bald crown of his head. There was an open book on his lap, and on the floor at his feet lay a dog that lifted its head and regarded Firestick's entrance more or less indifferently. The man's name was Sam Duval. The dog was Shield. Duval was a former New York City constable who suffered from bouts of tuberculosis. After the passing of his wife, he'd retired from the police force and moved to the drier climate of West Texas on the advice of a doctor who suggested it might be better for his health. During times when there was a prisoner in the lockup overnight, or on occasions when Firestick, Beartooth, and Moosejaw all had to be absent from town for a spell, they'd come to rely on the former constable as a trusted someone to keep an eye on things. As long as Shield was allowed to accompany him, and he was compensated in the form of meals from the nearby hotel dining room, he welcomed these breaks from the boredom of retirement.
"You can conclude a success," Firestick said in answer to Duval's question. "One grizzly, now deceased, is being field-dressed and skinned even as we speak."
Duval's brows pinched together.
"There's a term I never quite understood. When you bag an animal in the wild, you say dress it. Yet part of that process involves removing its pelt or hide. Doesn't that amount to actually undressing it?"
Firestick gave him a look.
"Boy, you big city fellas think of the doggondest things. You know that?"
"Matter of fact, That wasn't a big city thought, Duval countered. It never crossed my mind until I moved out here and heard the term and had explained to me what it meant. In the city, we got our meat from a butcher, and anything pertaining to hides or whatnot were bought from stores. The kind of critters we hunted down and shot were the two-legged variety, and their lousy hides weren't worth a damn, dead or alive.
Yeah, we got our share of that kind out in these parts, too, Firestick allowed, as he moved over and leaned back to half-sit on one end of his desk, facing out toward Duval. Speaking of which, any sort of trouble along those lines crop up while me and the boys was away?
Nary a peep, Duval replied. No strangers arrived in town, and what with all the surrounding ranchers keeping their wranglers close in to ride watch over their herds on account of that grizzly, the saloons in town were practically empty all day yesterday and last night.
Glad to hear things was quiet, Firestick said.
Then, after considering a moment, he added,
But the bad news about the good news is, once word spreads that the grizz has been bagged, there's a chance some might see it as a reason to celebrate, especially some of the ranch hands who are being kept on a tight leash. Those quiet saloons could be due for a rowdy turnaround.
Duval pursed his lips and tipped his head in a thoughtful nod. Never really thought about it that way, but you raise a good point. And too much rowdy celebration, as we both know too well, could mean those empty cells back in the lockup are in for an increase in business, too.
Afraid so.
In that case, said Duval, closing his book and rising to his feet, I think Shield and I ought to mosey on home for a while, in case you find it necessary to invite in some overnight guests and need us back here later on.
Let's hope it doesn't come to that. But I appreciate your willingness to sit in if it does, Firestick told him. We ran into an old friend this morning who will be joining us for supper out at the ranch come evening. I'll be back in town after that, though, in case things start busting loose.
Duval cocked a bristly eyebrow. You ran into an old friend while you were out grizzly bear hunting?
As a matter of fact, that's exactly how it happened. Trust me, if you knew this fella, that wouldn't sound nearly so strange. You'll get the chance to see for yourself, since he sounded like he plans on sticking around the area for a while.
Firestick paused, forehead puckering.
Come to think of it, unless this pal of mine has tamed down considerable, which he didn't seem to show no signs of, if he makes it to town tonight and starts hitting the saloons, you might even get to know him in the line of duty.
Chapter 5. It didn't take long for Firestick's speculation to come true about the town's saloons being due for a turn of rowdiness. It happened that very night, in fact, shortly after he returned to town following supper at the ranch. The meal had gone extremely well. The gregarious, tail-spinning Ripley was an instant hit with Miguel and Jesus, and even the usually rather reserved Victoria, who came from English aristocracy. She delighted in hearing stories about the mountain man days of Firestick, Moosejaw, and especially Beartooth. For his part, Ripley was on his best behavior when it came to keeping his language mostly sanitized and taming the yarns he spun somewhat so they weren't too graphic, yet still plenty colorful. The meal Victoria prepared was delicious. The wine flowed freely afterward. Laughter and camaraderie were abundant. Firestick hated to leave the gathering, but it was something he felt committed to do. The way he worked it with Beartooth and Moosejaw was that, with very few exceptions, they always took supper together at the Double M. This gave them the chance to simply visit as well as discuss events of the day related to their lawman duties or the ranch operation. Then, following the meal, they traded off, with one of them returning to town to make late rounds and see that things seemed relatively settled down before coming back home again. Tonight happened to be Firestick's turn for late town duty. Once he'd put the continuing conversation and laughter behind him and was headed for the distant lights of Buffalo Peak, he remained in good spirits. He knew he'd hear about it tomorrow if Ripley came up with any particularly rousing tales in his absence. What was more, nights like this
when he returned to town, involved another arrangement quite apart from making rounds and rattling doors to make sure they were locked. That arrangement involved one Kate Mallory, owner and proprietress of the Mallory House Hotel. The relationship between Kate and Firestick was a lot more than just that of a marshal and a businesswoman who sat on the town council. Their feelings for one another were hardly a secret around town, but even so, they kept everything relatively discreet. Firestick made it a point to spend time with her during the course of most days, including frequently having lunch with her in the hotel dining room. But it was on the nights, when he returned for late duty, that they had their most intimate moments. When he was done making his rounds, she would be waiting for him in her apartment at the rear of the hotel. Sometimes they'd make love, sometimes they'd just talk. Either way, this time together was always special. Though they'd never spoken about it at any length, they both sensed they were moving towards something lasting. But they felt no hurry, no pressure, and were giving it the time it needed to build and solidify. Firestick reflected briefly on this again tonight as he reached the edge of town. He knew he was comfortable with the pace of how things were going between them, but he sometimes worried that Kate, despite what she said.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.